I would ask for the roll call, please.
Mr. Achterman?
Here.
Mr. Farmer?
Here.
Mr. Morris?
Here.
Mrs. Schiffer?
Here.
Mr. Stucker?
Here.
Next order of business is to reorganize the board, and in doing so, I will nominate Mr. Foreman to be chairman. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Moved and seconded. Other nominations?
Yes, sir.
Foreman?
That's Stucker.
Stucker! I'm sorry, wait up. Why did I come up with that?
I was like, I was wondering who you were talking about.
I'll be all right.
That was awesome.
I knew who it was.
Don't try to confuse me with facts.
I'll be all right.
I'll second that. Is that a nomination?
No, Mike seconded it.
Okay.
Any other nominations? Someone want to close the nominations?
I'll close the nominations.
Is there a second?
So moved.
So be it. Bill, you're in charge. Congratulations.
I think we have to have a roll call.
Well, let's have a roll call.
Yep, roll call.
It's official.
All right. Mr. Achterman?
Here, yes.
Mr. Schiffer?
Here.
Or, yes. Yes or no?
Yes.
All right, Mr. Boers?
Yes.
Mr. Farmer?
Yes.
And Mr. Stucker abstained, right?
Yes.
There we go.
All right, now we need a pro tem. So in case you're not here, somebody else will take over.
I nominate Floyd.
I second that nomination.
Just waiting for the money.
Somebody close it.
Nomination's closed.
Second.
All right. Roll call vote. Mr. Achterman?
Yes.
Mr. Farmer? Or no, Mr. Stucker?
Yes.
Mr. Boers?
Yes.
Mr. Schiffer?
Yes.
We did it.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
Thank you. I guess.
There's no one to excuse. Nomination to approve the minutes from October 16th, 2018.
So moved.
Second.
Yeah, okay.
Everybody in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So, all right. Landon, do you want to swear in attendees?
I would leave that to the chairman to do, and the absence of the law director would be my opinion on that.
Mr. Stucker, would you like to swear in?
Probably,
yes. So whoever will be speaking, if you would like to stand, please.
You're speaking for
now.
Yes.
All right.
So, anybody about to give testimony in this proceeding, say I do?
I do.
That wasn't clear.
I'll just tell the truth.
There you go.
Yeah, the whole
truth. Swear to affirm by penalty of perjury that you'll tell the truth. Yeah, something along those lines. All right.
I need to get a copy of that to refresh that in my mind. Okay, so anyways.
Swear under penalty of perjury to tell the truth, say I do, I would say would probably be sufficient.
Anybody about to give testimony this proceeding, swear to tell the truth, under perjury by law, say I do.
I do.
Thank you. Okay, so today we are looking at the company of Shallow Creek Asset Development, LLC. They have requested a hearing Dave for property, 1295 Isaac Field Road. I guess, first of all, a representative for your company.
My name's Clay Corner.
My name's Clay. Clay?
Yes.
Corner, K-O-R-N-E-R.
Corner?
Yes, sir. Okay. What is your objection to this notice of violation?
Well, we had quite a few. Is everyone up to speed on what they are? Do we want to, are you Gordon?
Yes, I am. Yes.
Do we want to have Gordon run through the, would that be helpful, or is everybody?
Yes.
Everybody copes that.
If we want Gordon to run through the list of violations, that would be fine.
You can have a copy of the notice of violation. I originally was not going to be able to be here.
Yeah.
At the last second, I had someone else pick up my grandson, so I was able to attend, so I don't have the notice in front of me. I believe the notice actually covers two different violations. Under the 302.1 sanitation and 302.4 grass and weeds in excess of 6 inches in height. Under the property maintenance code, anytime the grass and weeds are over 6 inches in height, if a complaint's received, the property maintenance inspector goes out to try and justify whether the complaint is legit or not. And I take pictures when I do that. Unfortunately, these don't come out as well as the color ones when they're sent out. So basically what I found was that the grass and weeds inside the fence area and to the south side of the property were in excess of six inches of height. So the notice violation was issued for grass and weeds.
Does that include the grass across the street, down that fence line, across the woods in the front, down the side on the other properties too?
Basically, it's supposed to include any property that's inside the city limits.
So it's just our property that is being cited. It doesn't include across the street where all the grass is, the city right of way that isn't mowed. They don't have to mow theirs. Is that what I'm getting there?
Which property are we talking about? The complaint that came in actually didn't give a specific address at the time. And so sometimes when I get some of these complaints, I have to go out and kind of take a look at what I see. And in particular, when we have businesses, residential properties, things of that nature, if I take the pictures, I come back sometimes to discuss them in depth, sometimes with the law director, or have to make the decision, is usually based on that particular property. Now, since it didn't specifically spell out which address in particular on Isaac Beale, I actually cited two different properties on Isaac Beale. One of them, I believe, was 1432 Isaac Beale, and the other one being 1295 Isaac Beale. And what we try to do is make sure that we enforce the code fairly across the board. So we've had a variety of properties in Bucyrus where we have done that. Now, when I issue the citation, I try to do it based on the property in particular that is complained about, if I have a specific address. But sometimes that's not always the case. In this situation, I had to try and figure out which property the complaint was based on. Did that help?
Can I ask a question? How did this complaint initially come in? Did we have an anonymous?
Complaints can come in a variety of ways. They can fill out a green card, which simply has a lot of different type of violations on it that they can check mark. Sometimes they can come in through the office upstairs, through the safety service director, the mayor's office, Kelly. They can come in by telephone. They come in by email. So I don't always know specifically who the complaint comes from. I prefer not to know who the complaint comes from so that I make sure that I investigate all complaints that come in, and I try to address them fairly equally across the board.
So this specific complaint, how did it come in?
To the best of my knowledge, it came in as a either a complaint on the phone or from upstairs. I'm not sure. I'd have to go back and look. If it would have came in on a green card, that green card goes into the file and is kept with that. And like I said, it doesn't necessarily give a name or phone number. It just gives the information that the person is complaining about as far as the violation.
But we didn't have.
Then I go out and then I take the pictures to see if the violations are actually there.
But there was no green card complaint on this situation.
Not to my knowledge. If it's not included in the packet, there was no green card. No.
So this is the only place in the city that has tall weeds?
No.
That's what I'm getting?
No.
Oh. I just find it ironic. This is the second property we've been cited on. And what's unsanitary conditions?
Unsanitary conditions? Yeah. Anything that could contribute to things probably like such as infestation.
Infestation of what?
Bugs, ticks.
So it's your opinion of whether it's unsanitary, even though you've never been on the property or in the buildings?
Weeds and tall grass can contribute to infestation with things such as ticks, fleas, mice, rodents, things of that nature.
How many people currently are being cited for tall grass in the city?
I could not give you an exact figure.
But I mean, I could get a public records request and we could go through
roughly,
that.
Roughly 10 to 20% of the notices that I send out.
How many commercial properties?
Probably over the 2.5 years I've been in this.
No, I mean right now, how many commercial properties?
Probably 25% of the
How many commercial properties right now are being cited?
Any of them that I receive a complaint for that I go out and check and verify.
Is McFarland's Trailer Park being cited?
McFarland's Trailer Park, currently.
I mean, are they being cited for unsanitary conditions, abandoned buildings, everything else, or is that just completely different because they're on a witch list like we are?
What I would have to do is look in the file. I can't actually give that to you off the top of my head. I would have to go back and look and see what the latest violations are on a particular property you're talking about.
Do you think there's any?
That property was cited on numerous occasions.
Since the city took over?
Pardon me?
Since the city took over, they are?
Since I've been doing this particular job.
No, since the city took over that property, is there any citations out there for that?
I don't believe the city currently owns that property.
Okay.
Gentlemen, we're getting away from the subject here. This matter pertains to the property in question here right now. Do you have a disagreement with the situation of the property that you were cited for?
We do have some fundamental disagreements. I don't know, have you guys been out there recently? Have you looked at the property?
Yes.
Were you out there?
I was out there maybe about 2 hours ago.
Okay. So there's, you know, while we may fundamentally disagree with Gordon on some of his assertions, you know, we did trim up inside the fence. I don't know. If you personally agree or disagree that it's better or worse, but that is, you know, that has been taken care of. I guess our fundamental issue, and maybe Rob can speak a little bit more, is the, I think there was, I guess I'm kind of getting out of turn, but Gordon also cited us on behalf of Rob, I assume, with the motor vehicle ordinance due to, I'm sure Rob is an attorney, he can explain it maybe a little bit better. So that was the fundamental, our fundamental disagreement, and we appreciate y'all talking about. So I don't know if you want to continue. You know, we discussed the infestation issue, but Gordon, if you want to continue with the maybe apprising everyone on the automobiles or unlicensed motor vehicles.
Okay, in reference to the vehicle that I took pictures of, if you want me to go through the pictures, I can show you in particular which one was referenced. But
sure.
Under the property maintenance code, if a vehicle is either unlicensed or inoperative or partially disassembled, that falls under the property maintenance code. And I've had multiple sightings on various properties, both residential, commercial properties involving that same type of violation. The one in particular here, it appears to be a dump truck that has caught fire or had fire damage done to it. Since the weeds and grass had started to grow up around the vehicle itself, indicated it had not moved for a while, I'm not talking about tall grass. You'll see that there were some places on some of the, and I'm not sure if it was this particular one, but several of them, that when I tried to look at them to see, number one, whether they're inoperative, is I do look to see if grass and weeds are growing up around them to indicate that they have not moved for long periods of time. And the fact that this one was severely damaged, or appears to be severely damaged by fire to the cab area, were indications to me that the vehicle was inoperative. I did not see any type of license plate on them, so all my pictures are taken from the public right-of-way, so I don't necessarily always get the best views and the best pictures to try and pick up that information. And so I have to base off of a variety of aspects, such as the fact that it appears to be inoperable.
So that's the one you have a problem with in the picture?
In particular, that one, yes, sir.
Okay, Gordon, would you like to run through the pictures?
Okay. Make sure I know how to operate this, because this is the first time I've used this. Okay, what I did is I simply took a picture of the facility to start with. As you can see inside the fence and gates, there appear to be a variety of grass, weeds, things of that nature that are well in excess of 6 inches in height. That's what this picture shows here. This one will show the weed growth that is on the outside of the fence area. Normally that would be considered part of the property as well. A little bit closer up to show grass and weeds in excess of 6 inches in height.
Are you referring to the decorative bushes under the transformer, or?
I'd be talking about all this area in here.
Okay, the foreground. Thank you.
You actually measure the grass, or you just eyeball it?
I just strictly have to eyeball it. I try not to do it. I try not to even think about issuing a citation if it's anywhere just close to 6 inches. If it exceeds 6 inches by quite a bit, that's when I absolutely do issue a notice. Now, some properties I'm able to get up much closer to, such as residential properties.
I was just wondering, because like that dump truck you said about all the tall grass around it, how it had...
Well, I didn't particularly mean that one. When I indicated to you earlier that I've cited a lot of vehicles on residential properties as well as industrial type properties or business properties, I try and use that as one of my factors to look at to determine whether that vehicle is set for long periods of time and not moved, which could be an indication that it's inoperative. Again, I just took a variety of pictures trying to see in the different areas to see where grass and weeds was in excess of six inches. Such as along the fence here. This is the vehicle we were talking about that's outside of the fence. In this particular case, you don't see the grass like I was talking about in particular on this one, but I do not see any type of a license on it. As you can see, the vehicle has been heavily damaged, so it appears that very much so that it's inoperative, and that is part of the property maintenance code. Like I said, I just try to take a variety of pictures so I can kind of gauge the grass levels and different things of that nature. Like you indicated, in some places it's obviously not over 6 inches in height, but it's to kind of compare to show that there are other areas that it is. I think we've already went back to the past. Okay.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I have a question. What's the primary use of this property? I mean, is it for storage or what?
Storage. It's an impound yard.
For what?
Our business.
Yeah, but I mean for motor vehicles or anything?
We buy and sell. We own a scrap yard, right. And this is the impound yard because we have a very small scrap yard, and we buy fleets of vehicles from insurance companies. We probably have, 75, 85 school buses. sitting on a property that we just funnel through the yard.
So they're basically, they're being recycled or resold or whatever.
It's just an impound. It'd be similar to
So it's just a retaining area.
Yeah, it'd be similar to Massey's.
Rex Retail.
Bloomfields.
Yeah.
That's why we put the blinders all the way around the fence a few years ago, so people didn't have to look at our shit. You know, and we didn't have to put those up, but we put a substantial amount of money just in those blinders. I don't know if you're familiar with what plastic blinders cost in sheeting. We put a pile, we did that on our own free will, so, you know, but obviously that doesn't work, and so.
So this is a part of your salvage yard?
This is a separate kind of property that we have that's not affiliated with the salvage yard. It's two separate companies. We base our trucks and our towing out of this yard.
So basically, it's just an impound for you just to take them over to your place and then
Well, we have our personal stuff in here. There's stuff in here for our other companies. We have four companies total, it's just storage.
So you don't do any part of the disassembly or cutting up or anything at this location?
All of our equipment's located on Woodlawn Avenue.
With the exception of a couple forklifts, but.
We work on our personal road tractors in the building. Yeah. That's all we do. I mean, it's not affiliated with the salvage yard at all. We don't have any shears over there. We don't have any track cranes. We don't have anything. I mean, occasionally there'll be a track hoe over there and, you know, we'll move stuff around, but.
How much you own on the south side of the fence? Is your property line the fence line?
1 foot off the fence line.
1 foot off, okay. And the one there, it looks to me like you sprayed it one time. Have I seen dead weeds?
Yeah, we're always spraying our properties and mowing the fronts. We just didn't mow behind the fence because it's never been an issue till all of a sudden, you know, it's a big issue, you know, on two properties and everybody's trying to take away our birthday over it. It is what it is.
I want to get back to Bud. When that complaint came in, they didn't have an address?
No, it did not. I could show you a variety of cards, you know, that don't necessarily have names and addresses on them. Some of them will say the corner of this street and this street. You have to go out and try it and just look through to see if there are any type of particular problem in that area. Sometimes when a problem does come in on a card, the notice of violation may not just be limited to the one item or two items that might be on a card either. Is when I go out to do the inspection, I take a multitude of pictures to make sure that there are not other violations as well. And I try to make sure that I cover everything in the one notice.
I mean, was it specific in it? Was it specific that there was a truck out there? What I'm getting at, if you didn't know where it was located and they didn't give an address.
No, the main complaint was grass and weeds.
But I'm saying is there's grass and weeds all over on the other side and everything. To me, if you don't have a specific address, how can you cite somebody? That's what I'm saying. If you don't have a specific address to go to look at, to see what it is, how can you cite somebody? It might be the people across the street right across from the city garage, is what I'm saying.
I understand your point, but that's why I try to look to see if there are violations of any type in that area, because of the fact that there was no given address for that. And so if you do see violations, it's my understanding, it's my responsibility to try and take care of all violations that are covered under property maintenance code.
I understand
so that's what I'm trying to do.
I don't understand that, but there's also weeds and stuff on the opposite side of the road.
And the property on the opposite side of the road was cited and has been mowed. That was 1432 Isaac Buehler.
I went out, well, I made a personal visit out there today, like Mr. Stucker, and I seen the truck was gone. I don't know how long the truck had been sitting there. How long has it been there, I don't know.
It was at least there when the picture was taken, that's all I know.
So far right now it's gone.
Yeah.
And the weeds are gone.
I believe it was there in both sets of pictures that were taken on two different dates.
If I may, if the truck has been moved and the weeds have been mowed, aren't we done?
Well, how many more times are we going to be cited over every cotton picking property we have? We had good eats. We went through that, and all this is a witch hunt from sins that happened how many years ago?
This is the second one in 4 or 5 years.
Well, we went round and round. You turned us into the state of Ohio to the salvage dealer's license saying we were running illegal junkyard. This is, it just keeps going on and on. Every year, it's always something.
I think this is the second one in 3 or 4 years.
Well, here's, if I may interject, Rob. So our issue is, if the vehicles are behind the screening, from your position as the law director, are we operating within an acceptable manner pursuant to the property maintenance code?
If the vehicles are behind the screening, my opinion would be that those are covered by, as Ben was just talking about, the salvage the parts. Yeah, salvage license things.
The only one you have a problem with, excuse me for interrupting, it was that dump truck.
I think that's the only thing that Gordon cited. And this is the first time I see the pictures as well. Gordon is the investigator. He goes out and investigates whatever. So, if he cited for that and for the weeds and it's been mowed and the truck's been moved,
The language of the Gordon's letter is fairly ambiguous. Right, so that's why we made an appeal.
Sure.
It didn't say, hey, there's a green dump truck out front of the property. It just said there's unlicensed motor vehicles and pursuant to this, you can't do that. And that is our livelihood, and we do employ people.
And I appreciate that. And I understand your concern with filing an appeal to preserve and protect any rights. Normally and they don't get to me or my level of involvement until things have been ignored. But normally when Gordon sends out these letters, it's really a point to initiate contact with the property owner to open up a dialogue and say, hey, these are the problems that we've noticed. You could have just as easily called Gordon and say, hey, we're going to have the mower guy in next week, or we're going to mow next week and get the truck in, and it would have ended at that point just as easily. So, I mean, that's all he's looking for is compliance.
Basically, starting out the first year that I was involved with property maintenance, probably less than 20% of the notice of violations that went out actually had the property owner make contact with our office. And if you make contact with our office, we try to set up an appointment with you, sit down, look at the pictures, review everything, and try to indicate to you what needs to be done to be in compliance. Now, the first year, like I said, we probably had less than 20% of the people contact us when a notice of violation went out. If I have no contact with the property owner, and I have no way of making that direct contact with that property owner, then after the time period expires, my only recourse is to move it on to the law director step for action. And unfortunately, like I said, the first year, probably less than 20% of the people actually made contact with us until after they got a summons to go to court. This year, it's been much better. We're probably up to about almost 50 to 60% of the people are now, property owners are now making contact with our office so we can discuss these things and go over them. We've had a variety of property owners even request extensions and things of that nature. And if the extensions are reasonable in everything, I have no problem granting extensions, and city has had no problem with me granting extensions to get these items taken care of. Now, if the request for extension is extreme, then I will sit down with the law director and discuss it and say, what are your thoughts on this as far as this request for this? You know, as an example, if I issue a 10-day notice for cleanup of like grass, weeds, trash, rubbish, the vehicles and things of that nature, and somebody comes back and says, oh, I need 3 months, that's not realistic. So under those circumstances, I would discuss it with the law director. But so far, like I said, we've had good cooperation with people, and we're getting better as far as with the number of property owners that are finally starting to make contact with us. Like I said, the biggest problem was most of them wouldn't contact my office to talk to me until after they receive the summons to go to court. And that's not our intentions by any means. Our intentions are to simply try and resolve these things as quickly as possible. And we take all the factors into consideration when people contact us and talk to us.
And from a procedural standpoint, if it's been mowed and the truck's been moved, that was the basis of Gordon's original letter. So from a procedural standpoint, this board would sustain the appeal.
They've complied.
Yeah, this board would sustain the appeal, which is grant the appeal, and dismiss, and we're done.
Yeah, I just want to add, though, that your question was how many times is this going to happen to you with your business? It'll happen as many times as there are offenses that are noted and cited, and that it's not the city's responsibility to inspect and tell you when you need to do something to clean up your property. That's your responsibility to know what is needed to be done to your property and keep it taken care of. Okay?
Our fundamental issue was the second point. It wasn't, I wasn't sitting there arguing with Gordon or anyone about it. There's a couple, there's some grass that needs trimmed. It was about the unlicensed motor vehicles. That is their livelihood. That's why an appeal was filed. Otherwise, we would just move the property and move forward.
That, and I understand that.
That's not, I'm not here being contentious with Gordon saying, hey, you're being a pain in the butt over lawn mowing. That's not it. There was some corollary conversation along with that, but the purpose of this appeal was, and I'm glad Rob opted in, it's been very helpful, it's what, as our livelihood depends on the procurement, the transportation to this facility, and ultimately to 668 Woodlawn Avenue, what is the position of the city as far as a use for this property, right? So if Rob says you can't have any salvage vehicles or unlicensed motor vehicles, well then, it's behind screening, then that's why the appeal was generated.
When it's behind screening, that falls under that salvage stuff that, is with the Ohio thing. And Landon is the go-to guy on the zoning classifications, but I think you're industrial out there. I think pretty much everything you guys are doing out there is you're in the right zoning district.
Mm-hmm. So is this property licensed as a salvage facility?
This is not. This is not.
Okay, I think there's a question there if you're holding salvage equipment, vehicles, well, then, in that facility, that would be in a violation itself.
Well, that would be not within our jurisdiction, But okay. This is the salvage dealer stuff is very akin to the mobile home situation that we faced a few years ago, mm-hmm. where the state comes in and says we're regulating this. And much like when the federal government comes in and says they regulate, then everybody else has to get out of that business. When the state comes in and regulates that area, it's no longer our concern, but it's not our business to be involved in. So with salvage yards, it's one of those areas where the state comes in and regulates, and locally, as long as it's in a area that qualifies, it's pretty much it. Where we do get involved and where we do have authority to regulate is when it kind of comes outside a little bit, and with that truck becomes offensive to the code, not because it's a salvage vehicle, but because it's an unlicensed vehicle. And it would be no different if that was a 1972 Pinto that somebody parked there 30 years ago and just left. From our perspective, it doesn't matter that it's destined for salvage or scrap or whatever, or abandoned or anything like that. We look at it from that perspective, not from the salvage dealer perspective.
I want to clarify, we don't do any salvage work as far as disassembly or anything over there. All that is just an impound lot. So it's not like that we're doing what we're doing on Woodlawn over there as far as cutting up trucks and everything else.
But it's just a storage facility there for taking it over to the Woodlawn.
It's an impound lot. So if it can't get into Woodlawn, the trucks will sit there and then they'll go from there, or the heavy equipment will sit there and then it'll go over to Woodlawn. But we do no disassembly. There's no hours there as far as general public coming in there dumping off.
You guys.
Mr. Chairman, it appears to me like they've complied with the issues that were mentioned in the notice of violation, so I think the notice of violation needs to be dismissed and they go on their merry way. Okay?
I'll second that motion.
So, before we make a motion, Glenn seconded.
Motion to dismiss the violation?
Yes, ma'am.
Seconded. Roll call vote then. Mr. Farmer?
Yes.
Mr. Octerman?
Yes.
Mr. Boers?
Yes.
Mr. Schiffer?
Yes.
Mr. Stucker?
Yes.
And thank you, gentlemen. You did a nice job of cleaning up around here. Didn't notice that today.
Thanks for your time.
Well, if you get another notice, hopefully you know, call Gordon.
Call Kurt.
And you can get it resolved.
Not until January.
Call Gordon and get it worked out ahead of time so we avoid the.
That's the biggest thing.
No, you know.
Should do it during.
Okay, we know. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, sir.